patting myself on the back for this particular design. This may be one of my very favorite things that I've designed ever, and that's like 10 years of designs. I mean, seriously. One of the things that I try to do when I'm designing new projects is I'm looking at trends that are happening out there in, you know, the regular jewelry world, costume jewelry, the things that you're buying at your local department stores, what you're seeing in the magazines, what the stars are wearing, that kind of thing. Tassel necklaces are so huge right now, and so I really wanted to create a gorgeous looking tassel necklace out of seed beads and do it with my bead weaving. And I went through about a good 6 or 7 iterations before I finally came up with the perfect set of ingredients. One of the things I was having trouble with was making the dangles on the tassel really soft and flowy and full enough. And I came up with a really cool trick on that. Actually, I didn't come up with it. I just discovered it. I can't take credit for the idea. Actually, I believe it was the Miyuki company that put out a project sheet and showed how to create this fringe this way. And I just thought it was brilliant. And it has made all the difference with this gorgeous tassel that we're going to create today. So let me show you first how we're going to create the little end cap that is the top of the tassel. And then we'll do a second part that shows you how you're going to create all that beautiful fringe that comes out of the end cap. So let's take a look at the beads. Here I am ready to go. I've got this little stopper bead on here. So this is just a random bead that I happen to have on my bead tray from a previous project. And so I've attached this because when we start out to create our end cap, we're going to be using tubular peyote and we're picking up 24 seed beads. So that's quite a few to handle without some kind of stopper bead. So you're going to need that stopper bead. And so your very first step is going to be picking up 24 of these seed beads. When you go to get your thread, you're not going to need tons and tons of thread for this because tassel is created in parts. And so really, I'm going to say about 3 to 4 feet is going to be enough. I would actually go 4 feet. Go 4 feet, and that'll make sure that you have enough to do the entire tassel. So now that I was talking, I totally lost count of my beads here. So let's check it real quick. So there's 4, 8, 12, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 22. I need 2 more. And it is important that you get the number correct on this as you do this. So double check it before you start going. So we're going to peyote around on this. The very first step is going to be to turn it into a circle. So I'm going to pass through all these beads again, starting at the bottom, the tail end, really, and go through them again. I do not like to tie knots. So a lot of times people will have learned from other teachers or self-taught, they just tie the thread into a knot to turn this into a circle. The reason I don't like to do that is simply because what if I need to go back through a bead that then is all plugged up with a knot? So I'm not a big fan of knots when I'm doing circles. However, having said that, if it really concerns you not to have a knot there, then go ahead and do the knot. I mean, worst case scenario is that it's a little tough for you to get through a bead. So here I've come all the way around. Notice that my tail thread is coming out of the next bead here. So I'm actually going to go through that again, which will turn it into a complete circle. If you did it one bead shy of that, it would not be a complete circle. Now at this point, we don't need that extra bead there any longer, so I'm going to just kind of get rid of that. Okay, the other thing here is that this moved on me, so I ended up with a humongous tail as I was going through those beads again, so I'm going to just kind of cinch it down a little bit. I want about 4 to 6 inches left below the circle so that I can end that off later. Okay, so now we get to peyote around. We're going to use the same seed bead, and this is just regular peyote as we go around. So it's picking up a bead, skipping one for it to sit on top of, and passing through the next bead. And as you do this, what's going to happen is that these beads that we're adding, so we're skipping a bead, going through the next, they're going to sit out to the side. for this first round, and that's totally fine. Do not try to worry about turning it into a tube yet. That is going to happen on the next round. It's going to happen naturally. I'm going to give you some tips on how to turn that into a perfect tube. So right now we're just kind of creating this so that it's sitting flat. So skipping one, passing through the next. As always, when you're doing this, for instance, this is a good example. This particular bead is particularly wide. So cull out your beads. If you've got any that are extra small or extra wide, the more uniform you can make your beads, then the more uniform your piece will be too. So any of those really weird ones, go ahead and get rid of them. When I create your kits, I take that into account, that a percentage of them are going to end up on the floor when you spill them because your cat came over and tried to play with your bead project, or your dog came over and wanted to love on you. This happens in my house all the time. And so I put extras in for that. And I put extras in for any of those wonky beads that you want to get rid of because they're just not perfect. Okay, we're almost all the way around. Kind of hold that tail thread underneath so that it's not in my way. Let's see here. So here we are on, yes, we're on the last bead that we're going to add. So I'm skipping a bead, I'm passing through the next one, and then here's my first one that I added on the next round. And see how it's that sticky, how it's so sticky outy? So what we're going to do is we're actually going to do, this is what's called a step up. We need to get to the sticky outy beads to add the next round. So as I add this one, what I'm going to do here is I'm skipping a bead, I'm passing through that next one in that initial round circle, and then I'm also going to do the step up and go through that first sticky outy bead. Now you don't have to do this all in this at the same time, but a lot of people like to because it just makes sense for them to do it in one pass. Now we've got the setup for peyote, which it will be super easy. So you can see where you've got the sticky outies and the down beads, and we're picking up a bead and we're just going to pass through the next sticky outie all the way around. Now as we're doing this, because we do want this to turn into a tube, as we're doing this, what we're going to do is we're going to kind of pull this upward. It's like towards yourself. And then I kind of use my finger and kind of pinch this center part down a little bit. It's going to take you a couple of beads before you get something that's really going to show what we're doing here, but pulling upward, kind of pinching down. See how now this is kind of creating a little bit of a wall going on here? This will get much more pronounced as we keep going along. And also notice that I'm holding it back over here. I'm not holding this part that I'm trying to encourage to sit upward. So I'm pulling upward and in, keeping my finger in the center there. Oops. There we go. Just caught my thumb on the thread. Up and in. So now you can really see where this is really starting to bow in. Up and in. This is one of those too thin beads that I was talking about. So that's another one that I don't want to put in my project because he's going to throw all the spacing off. So here we go. We're about halfway around. Okay, see how this is working? And you can even kind of put your finger in there to kind of help it turn into a tube. Some people will use like a straw or something for that center part. In this case, a straw is not going to be thick enough for that center. You might have a piece of wood, a dowel or something that might be the right size. But if you can get away with out it without using something in the center, especially then you're not limited to, if you learn how to do it without the dowel is what I'm trying to say, then you're not limited to stuff that you can find the right size dowel for the center. You can work with anything. So see how now I'm kind of putting my finger in the middle here to help encourage all this to move forward. And here I am on my very last bead of this round. And the reason I can tell that this is going to be the last bead of this round that I'm adding is I've got this extra hot, this extra bit of step up right here that's going on. So I'm picking up a bead. This is the bead that it's going to sit on top of. Here's the next bead for it to go through. And then here's the very top sticky outy bead. So that's going to be my step up. So I'm going through the one on the same part, on the same round, and then now through that very first sticky outy bead, like so. And here we got our, I've turned it into a ring. Now it's vertical. On your next round, it still has a little bit where it's kind of coming out a little bit like this, but on your next round, that will really disappear. So what you're going to do is you're going to keep adding rounds until you reach the number that it talks about in the instructions. As you're doing this, you want to make sure that you're getting that step up every time. So one of the things that I encourage people to do if they're not really confident with their step ups is you're going to be adding 12 beads on each round. So go ahead and separate those 12 beads out. Oops, that one flew away. That's a floor bead. You know, separate them out, and then you know when you're adding that very last bead, that's going to be where your step up is, okay? So you're going to keep doing that, and what ends up happening is you end up with something that looks like this. So this is the right number of rows. The way you are going to count rows on this, you can try to count it on a diagonal, but that can be a little difficult. So instead, notice how you've got these columns, if you're looking at it this way, I'm kind of looking at it sideways, right? So, but you've got these straight lines of beads, and one will start out with a sticky outy on this end, and then it'll be indented on this end, and then the very next row over will be a sticky outy on that end where the other one's indented, and then indented where that one's sticky outy. So those two columns together, if you count those, that's going to be the number of rows that you have. So in this case, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So I've done 12 rows. So you need two adjacent columns here and to count them, and that will be the number of rows that you've got. Now we need to do a decrease at the top, and the reason we're doing this is so that we can create a nice flat top for the top of our end cap here. So the way we're going to do this is we're going to start skipping some beads, and we're going to skip this very first intersection where normally we would add a bead. We're just going to pass through the next sticky outy. So we're not even worrying that our thread is going to show right there, because what's going to happen is as this folds all over, it gets all sucked in and you will never ever see it. So you're just going to skip one and then take two regular peyote stitches. So here's one and two. Okay, then we're going to skip one and then two peyote stitches. One and two. Here we're skipping one. This is our third one that we're skipping. Two regular peyote stitches. So one with a bead, two with a bead, and then skipping. And then two more. Regular stitches, like so. So if you look, now we have these deep V's that are going on in here. And what we're going to do is we're going to turn those into corners. These are going to be like little flaps that are going to go down. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4 of those little corners. And so what we need to do for this first one is we want to get to the other side of this deep V. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to pass through the beads to get up to that top part right there. So that first one, you don't want to be in the valley. You want to be up on top of the hill. Okay, So I'm going to actually, at this point, I'm going to switch to this purple color seed bead so that you can see better where these decreases are happening. Now you at home, you're still going to be using the same color bead. So this is just so that you can see what's happening a little bit better. But notice how we've got space right here for a single stitch, regular peyote stitch. So we're going to do that. I'm just using this oddball color, okay? And then we want to put one bead in the center of this big valley. So we're going to take another bead and we're passing all the way over to the top sticky outie on the other side. And as we do this and as we tighten, remember how we're going to tighten inward? And you can see how that starts bending in and it starts bringing all that together. So here we have room for a regular peyote stitch. So we're picking up one, like so. Now we have to bridge that big gully right there. So we're going from here all the way over to the top sticky outie on the other side of the valley. Okay, as we tighten, it goes inward. We've got room for one regular stitch here. Okay, here's another big valley that we need to cross. So we're passing through the first sticky outie on the other side. Okay, here we've got room for one regular stitch. Like so, and then one more big valley here. And what we want to do is catch that bead that is before the first one that we added on this round. So if it helps you, you can kind of go down and up the valley and to figure out which one it is. You can count. So one, two takes you down into the bottom of the valley, and then one, two takes you to the top. So it's that second one past the bottom of the valley right there. Okay. And then as you tighten that up, look how now we have this nice squared off top. But let's close that top off just a little bit more. So we're, our step up is going to be through that very first bead of that we added on this round. So it's just basically moving forward by one. We are going to, this is going to seem really strange, but we're only going to pick up a single bead. So we're only going to add four beads on this round. So what we're going to do, I'll switch back to the other color so you can see where this is going, but I'm just going to skip this one in the corner and pop all the way over here. Okay. And then same thing here. We're picking up one. We are skipping the guy in the corner and all the way over to there. Okay. Pick up one, skip the one in the corner, all the way over there. And then one more bead to add. And we're skipping the guy in the corner, going through the next one. And look how that all tightened up right there. And so this last four that you added, what I like to do is to tighten this all up and make it the most secure is I like to go through those last four again. Now here's another thing to remember. This is hard to see if you're not familiar with doing this kind of decrease and if you are using all a single color. So here's a couple of things. Number one, don't stress, because worst thing that can happen is you could accidentally go through the wrong bead and it might not look 100% perfect right up here. We're going to add a set of fire polish up here, so that's going to cover some of this, so nobody's going to see it. Most people are going to be looking at your piece from this side, so if there's a little bobble on the top here, it's not the end of the world, okay? So, you know, I can do this pretty well because I've done this a whole bunch of times. If it's your first time, it might be a little stressful for you to see where those beads are. So now that I'm up here at the top, what I'm going to do right here is I'm going to add four fire polish beads on top here. It's just going to elevate where we attach the loops that will go onto your silver silk chain. And it's just a nice little decorative thing to do. So what I've put in your kits are these little tiny 2 millimeter fire polish beads. So they are the smallest fire polish beads that are made. And what we're going to do is we're going to kind of basically square stitch them on these last four beads. So the bead that I'm coming out of, I'm now picking up a 2mm fire polish. I'm going to go back through that same bead that I'm coming out of again. So I'm going in a circle around it to attach that on top. And now I can move forward to the next bead. And we're going to do the same thing. So I'm picking, as I went through that next bead, picking up the 2mm fire polish, passing back through that same bead that I was coming out of. So we're kind of square stitching it on top. Move forward to the next bead in that round, like so. Picking up the fire polish, back through the bead that I was coming out of. And now I can move forward to the last of those four beads on that last round. Pick up one more of the fire polish and back through that bead again. This may not surprise you, because if you've done many of my projects before, you know that I am a queen of reinforcement. So what we're going to do with these four fire polish beads is we're just going to pass through just the fire polish and do that a couple of times. So now I'm moving, that's basically my step up to the fire polish. And this is a terrible color to use. It's all dark. I can't see the darn holes. There we go. There's the bead hole. It really, by reinforcing these, it really puts those beads where we want them and makes them sit the way we want them to, because we want them to sit like little neighbors and be nice and tight in there. There we go. And one more will take us all the way around. Okay, so if I were, doing this for myself, I'd probably go around that one more time. But since I'm on camera, you should go around and reinforce it a little bit more. I'm just going to move forward. Because at this point, what we can do is we can attach the loops on the top here. And what you're going to do is, with your thread coming out of one of those fire polish beads, we're going to pick up some of the size 11 seed beads. The exact number will be in your instructions, and there's going to be a little bit of a trial and error that you're going to need to do. You're going to have a couple of decisions to make, whether you want this tassel to come off of the silver silk and be detachable, which I always like. Then you're going to want your loops to be a little bit bigger so that it'll go over the clasp. If you want it to stay on that same chain, then you can make your loop a little smaller so that it is permanently attached to the chain. So you actually have some choices here. So I picked up a random number of seed beads here, and then I'm just going to pass through that same fire polish bead again. So I just created a loop on top of that single fire polish bead. You should go and reinforce this round again. I'm just going to move forward. I'm going to create a second loop out of this same fire polish. And you'll want to pick up the same number of seed beads. And because I wasn't counting, I have no idea what that was, but we'll kind of guesstimate here. I can't talk and count at the same time. I have many skills, but that is not one of them. Okay, so let's just pretend that's not going to be as many, but let's just pretend that that's the same amount. So then I'm going to go right back through that same fire polish again. So you're going to have two loops coming out of that single fire polish bead. And then likewise, you would go ahead and reinforce this second loop also. Then we're going to move forward or go around that circle by two fire polish. Because what you want to do then is add two more loops on the fire polish on the opposite side of that little set of four. So same thing here, you're going to add two more loops. So a random number of seed beads. I'm going to make this one really small so that I don't have to spend a lot of time doing that on camera. Okay, and then back through the fire polish. You would reinforce it and then add your fourth loop. And then you have this pretty little decorative four loop bail that will go over your chain. So when we come back, I'm going to show you, there's going to be some embellishment that we're going to do along the outside edge of this end cap. And so once we get that embellishment done, we're going to be done with the end cap. We're close. Now, you know, I couldn't leave that cute little end cap just plain. I had to add some embellishment to it. So it's a really simple little embellishment, but it adds a lot of extra oomph to your piece. So let's show you how you're going to get in position to add it and how you're going to add it. So here we are. You have added your loops. And what we're going to do is from that fire polish that you're coming out of on that top, you're going to work your way down so that you're coming out the center of the side. And so it doesn't matter exactly what thread path you take to get there. What you want to do when you're working towards that side is look for one of the columns here that has the sticky outy bead on the bottom. Okay, so there's several, you know, every other one has a sticky outy on the bottom. And what you want to do is to work your way so that you're coming out the third sticky outy bead up from there. So it doesn't matter how you get there, so I'm just going to kind of move from closest seed bead to closest seed bead. And it doesn't matter where on the end cap, like on what side you start out, because we're going to do the same thing all the way around. So here I am coming around the corner. I'm working on a diagonal. I'm getting lucky and I'm being able to go multiple beads at a time. If you need to, you can do a single bead at a time to get where you're going. It's no problem. Okay, so here I'm close. See, I'm in the fourth bead from one of the indented ones. So if I then come down here, I'm closer again, but I'm on the fourth bead, not the third bead. And you know what? Actually, I'm going to go ahead and attach this to the fourth bead because what we're going to add is going to come down a little bit. And so it's going to actually be more centered if I come out this fourth bead anyway. So 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm in perfect position right now to start adding beads. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to do a little what's called stitch in the ditch. And what I'm talking about is, so you've got my threads coming out of this bead here. See how there's a just like a little valley right here where there's a bead on either side before I come to the next bead that's on that same plane. So there's this area, kind of what we call the ditch right there. We're going to attach our bead into that ditch, and we're going to do it by passing through the next bead that is on that same plane. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to attach 2 millimeter fire polish all the way around in those ditch spots. So I'm just going straight ahead through that next seed bead that's straight ahead, and then that fire polish is going to sit in that ditch. So now here I am on the next intersection. I'm picking up a fire polish. It's going to sit in this ditch, and I'm going through the bead that's straight ahead. These fire polish are not super evenly sized on the edges, so be a little bit cautious. I have not had any of them break thread yet, but it is possible that it could happen. So when you're pulling, try to pull straight through these fire polish. And you don't have to use your tightest tension. Those of you who are really strong when you're pulling your thread through, use the same kind of tension that you might use if this were a crystal, okay? Because you just don't want it to get so tight that it becomes a problem. Okay, so I'm continuing to go all the way around here. And so you'll be adding a total of 12 of these fire polish as you go around. Okay. Come on, little guy, where's your hole? There he is. Okay. This is going to be the last one that we add on this round, and it will not surprise you to know that you're going to have a step up here. So what we're going to do is we're going to pass through that seed bead. You'll have to probably do these in separate stitches. And now we're going to take our needle and pass through the first fire polish that we had added right there. Okay, so now we have this cute little sticky outy bead all the way around. This is a good way for you to see how it's sticking out all the way around. And your thread is coming out of the 2mm fire polish. So now we're going to add basically a round of netting in between here. And that's going to be, you're picking up a seed bead and a fire polish and a seed bead. And you're passing through the next sticky outy fire polish. What's going to happen as you do this is they're going to start looking a little wavy. And that is totally okay and normal for that to happen, because we're going to fix that on the last round of this embellishment. So you're just going to continue to go all the way around, picking up a seed bead, a fire polish, and a seed bead, and going through the next sticky outy fire polish. So I think that I'm going to have my producer do his magic here, and he's going to speed me up into warp speed so that you can see what this looks like when we get to the end here. Okay, so here I am. I'm ready to add the last seed bead, fire polish seed bead. I'm going to pass through that fire polish that I was originally came out of when I started this whole round. And then you know what's going to happen next. It's step up time. And so for our step up, we're going to pass through the first seed bead and the fire polish of that little wave that we added all the way around. So we want to be coming out at that center fire polish. Now see how, well, I said that this was going to look wonky, and it does. Some of them are going up, some of them are going down. It's not all consistent. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to fix all of that, because what we're going to do is we're going to pick up a fire polish and simply pass through the next fire polish in the next wave over. And as we do this all the way around, it's going to bring those waves down, and they're going to sit flush with the end cap here as you're doing this. It just tightens it all up, makes them sit where we want it to. See how they're kind of sitting down? And you'll do that all the way around. And once you have that finished, then you are actually finished with this entire end cap. And you can either end this thread off if you're running short, like I kind of am, or if you've got quite a bit of thread left, go ahead and leave it. We can use it to sew the tassel strands in later. If you end up ending it off, don't worry about it, because we can use the thread coming from the tassel strands to attach it also. We have options. We can use either way. So go ahead and finish and add that fire polish all the way around. Again, I would reinforce it. If you've got enough thread, go ahead and reinforce that last all fire polish round, and then that whole little end cap will be complete. Then we just have the fringe to worry about. So come on back when you get that done, and I'll tell you all about the fringe. Now that you've got this lovely little decorative end cap, let's create all the fringe that's going to go on the inside. Now let me tell you, I messed with this fringe for like, I don't know, hours and hours and hours, days, trying to get just the right kind of drape and softness and fullness that I wanted. And it turns out that there were two magic ingredients. One is that instead of using Fireline, which I use for almost everything, and I have you using for the bead cap itself, instead of using Fireline, we're actually going to use thread for the actual fringes that come down out of the tassel. Reason is it's just softer. You get a much softer drape from the thread. I like to use the Fireline for the end cap itself because you get a better tension on it. It's stronger. It's more sturdy. When I did the fringe with the Fireline, they all kind of sat a little bit wonky, and I don't know, I just wasn't really happy with how it looked. So switching to thread made a big difference. So that was the number one thing. The number two thing is, in the past when I've done a fringe coming out of a tassel type thing, and this is the way I have it done in the book, is I created just a little ring of seed beads, and I have all of those coming out of the ring of seed beads, and then the ring goes up into the tassel itself, which is fine, but I wasn't getting kind of that outside edge fullness that I wanted so much. So our magic ingredient is going to be that we're going to create all these fringes on ribbon, and then we're going to wind that ribbon up and sew the ribbon up inside the end cap. It's the coolest thing, and it makes the prettiest tassel. So let's take a look at what we're doing here. I got this ribbon. This is a 6 millimeter gross grain ribbon. The reason I chose the gross grain is because it does have an edge here, a pretty sturdy edge, because we're going to be sewing this right onto the very, very edge here. So you wouldn't want to, say, use maybe a satin or something that might unravel on the edge there. So you want something that's got a nice sturdy edge for this. This is something that I got at my local craft store. It's 6 millimeters wide. You could actually go a little bit smaller than 6 millimeters. I think that they had a 3 millimeter ribbon also. If you go bigger than that, you can use something that's wider than this, but you'll probably have to cut it down on the top edge to fit it inside your end cap. So, but what was great is it was inexpensive and it came in a huge color array. And so you can pick a color that, if it were to peek out, say, in between the beads of your end cap a little bit, or even maybe just a little tiny bit right above your fringe here, you can pick a color that will recede into the background. So what I'm going to use on this particular tassel here is I'm going to use the black, but for demonstration purposes in the video, I'm going to use the yellow so that you can see better. I'm using black thread, and you can see what's going on with that black against the yellow, okay? So, in your kits, I cut you about 8-inch pieces of ribbon, which is plenty of ribbon. You're going to end up cutting quite a bit of this off. But I found that it's easier if you have something a little bit bigger to hold on to. So that's why I like to give you plenty of ribbon to work with. And there's two things that you can do to get this thread attached to your ribbon. The first is you can tie a couple of knots on the end of your thread here. And this is optional. I like to do it. We're actually going to eventually put just a dab of glue on this thread at the point that it is attaching to the ribbon. But this just helps me feel a little more secure until I get to the point where I've finished all those fringes and I'm ready to do the glue. So I'm going to tie a couple of knots right on top of each other here, like so, just so it won't poke through the ribbon. And then I'm going to pick kind of a spot here. I'm going to kind of grab the middle of the ribbon, and I'm just going to weave in and out a couple of times. This is all going to be hidden. It does not need to be pretty. You've got plenty of ribbon, so you don't have to worry about using up too much real estate or anything. Let me just go in and out one more time here, like so. So there I am in the middle. But where I want to actually add the beads is down at the end, or at the edge. So now I'm going to do the same thing in and out to get to this bottom edge. And there we go. I keep trying to sew myself to the ribbon. Okay, so now I'm coming out just right above that edge. There's just this little line right here, and so that's like the perfect spot to hit. But if you hit a little higher than that, it's no big deal. So right here, I'm ready to start picking up beads. And you're using little tiny seed beads here. And what you want to do is pick up the number of beads that it says in your instructions. But remember that that is just what I used in the sample. And so if you wanted to make your fringes a little bit shorter, you can do that. If you want to make them a little bit longer, you can do that. You might just have fewer fringes because I calculated the number of beads in your kits based on a certain number of fringes. I think it was 24 fringes. So you've got, you know, enough beads for that, probably more. But if you do all of them much longer, you might have a problem. You might start running out of beads, and you just might have fewer than 24 fringes, which is also fine. So don't stress about that either. It'll still be a perfectly beautiful tassel. I'm just going to make a little small fringe here so that you don't have to see me picking up tons of them. What I did is I'm kind of anal retentive, and so I counted how many beads I wanted. If that drives you nuts and you're not good at counting or you've got a lot of distractions, put a little measuring tape right here and you can just do the beads to a certain measurement and just make sure that each of your tassels just hits that certain measurement. So now we want to turn around and come back up again. So I'm going to use those little 2 millimeter fire polish as a pretty decorative element on the bottom of these fringes. So I'm picking up a fire polish and a seed bead, and a fire polish and a seed bead, and a fire polish. So 3 fire polish with seed beads in between them. You'll bring those up to your beads. And then this is where I kind of hold some tension on this. I'm trying to hold the beads up against the ribbon. And I'm going to start passing back through just the seed beads. So here's that fire polish, seed bead, fire polish, seed bead, fire polish. Those are going to be just the little tip on the end. I only want to go back and pass back up, starting with all those seed beads. And you will probably have to do it in multiple pulls of your thread. When you pull that first time, make sure that these sit in a nice, pretty, in that nice, pretty little arrangement. Sometimes this bottom one wants to sit way up high, and I usually kind of try to poke it down a little bit. Then you'll go all the way back up your fringe. So you're coming out that last seed bead. Sometimes what can happen is, let me kind of make this happen. When you get up to the top, you end up with a lot of thread. Like say, sometimes this will happen. And it's just a natural thing that happens because you are, you know, manipulating this and it's moving around on you and that kind of thing. So the way to get all that extra thread sucked up there is hold that bottom center fire polish, because that's going to be the exact middle of that thing, and then pull on your thread, and that will pull all the way up so that it's sitting next to the ribbon, okay? Now what we have to do is we just have to anchor this second piece of thread, thread path through your fringe here, plus then get you in position to add your next fringe. And you want to move that next fringe over just a little bit. So this is just an eyeball kind of thing. You can decide how far apart you want these fringes. I kept them pretty close to each other. So what I'm going to do here is I'm actually going to go from the bottom up and over. So you can see that I'm moving over probably about a millimeter here, maybe 2 millimeters, and coming out the top now. So my first pass of thread came out the top, came down, came back up. I came from the bottom up, and now here I am coming over the top again. I'm at least enough space so that this next fringe won't sit on top of this one, and I'm ready to add my next fringe. And you're going to keep adding those fringes all the way along, basically until you run out of fire polish beads, is what I like to do, is just make sure that I have done the maximum number of fringes that I can do. So let me just switch samples on you here, because this is what it's going to look like when you get all of those fringes attached. And you'll notice that in this particular case, I have switched back to the black thread. That's because I wanted to do this in a way that is going to be the final fringe on this. I also changed to black seed beads because I love black and bronze together. So this is going to be a personal sample for me. You will end up having to add thread somewhere along the way, because this does take a lot of thread as you're going back and forth here. When you go to add and end your thread, you're going to do it the same way that you did to start out with. As a matter of fact, I'm ready now on this piece. Oops, let's get the right thread and right needle here. I'm ready on this piece to end off this thread. I know this is black on black, so you're probably not going to see it too much, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to come up to that halfway mark and then do the in and out back towards the center here a couple of times, and then I'll be ready to clip this off. So that in and out is a really effective way of making your thread stay. The reason we're going to the center here of the ribbon is because we're going to add a little glue, and we don't want that to happen too close to the beads. Plus, it just makes the thread travel a little bit farther, so it's less likely to unthread on you. Okay. Like so. Now, as long as I don't go crazy, I can actually just cut this off, and I just don't want to go crazy pulling on this last piece. I like to cut the thread a little bit higher than the rest of this ribbon, so that if I want to, I can bring all of these threads up, like so, because there are several, because like I said, I had to add thread along the way. And you can kind of roll that in when we go to roll all of this into a round piece. And you can roll it so that they sit along the top, and then you will just put glue along that top edge. If this seems a little fussy to you, then you can go ahead and just dab a little bit of glue on these intersections where the thread is coming out here. Either way, it totally is up to you which way you want to go. As far as glue goes, you have options with glue too. This one, my particular favorite glue to use on this is called Gem Tack. It's because it's a fabric glue. It's made to glue for fabric, and since this ribbon is a piece of fabric, it's perfect for that. It comes out of the tube white, but then it dries clear. Again, we don't really care though, because this is all going to be in underneath our end cap. So even if you use a glue that will show, no problem, because it's all going to be in under the end cap. Now, notice how much extra ribbon I have here. So I'm going to go in. I'm going to actually forego the gluing right now, because I would have to wait for it to dry before I showed you how to stitch it into the end cap. So I'm going to live dangerously here right now. So I'm just going to kind of cut the ribbon here. I want to cut the ribbon a little bit on this side. I want to make sure that I don't cut where the thread started coming out. Remember, I can trim this thread later, so I'm not worried too much about it. So here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to bend these two ends in, and then basically in half, and then I'm going to bend that in half. And you know what? I shouldn't have ended off that thread, because what I could do right now is be using that thread that I had attached here, and I keep folding it over in half until I have something that is going to fit on up into your end cap here. And if I'd been smart and left this thread attached, then I can use that thread to then stitch this together like a little pancake. So I'm still going to do that. I'm going to use this thread, but I'm going to have to reattach it a little bit. But by going back and forth through here, remember, it's not going to be seen, so it doesn't have to be pretty. Doesn't that just feel good that you don't have to worry too much about it? So see how I'm just going back and forth until I feel like it's nice and secure. And because I'm going back and forth, I could tug on this right now and this would not come out at all, actually. I will probably still, when I go to finish this off at home, I will probably still just put a little tiny dab of glue there, just because. All right, so now look at that pretty little tassel. So here we go. I will trim all of these extra little threads up at the top, making sure that I don't trim the thread that the working thread that I'm working with here. Okay, I'm going to take the needle on this working thread, on this piece, and I'm going to randomly poke it through about the center of the end cap from the inside out, like so. So like right above the line of embellishment. And here we go. So here is us attaching this. So this is like so not brain surgery. You are just going to pass through one or two beads. Doesn't even matter. It might be the embellishment fire polish. It might be the seed beads on the end cap itself. I'll just pass through a couple of them. And now I'm going to take this needle and I'm going to poke it straight through the entire center of this. Oop, see my ribbon is coming out here because I want to make sure that as I'm poking through the center, I'm also poking through that ribbon. And this is what's attaching that the ribbon. There we go. And you'll feel the resistance of the ribbon as you push that through there. So that's going to be once. I looped my thread accidentally around this top loop. So let me loosen that up and get that out of there. So that's something to watch out for, is those looped threads. Okay. So now my thread's coming out over here. So I'm going to do the same thing. Let me pass through a couple of seed beads. Like so. Now I'm going to poke straight through the entire center here again. So I'm going to do this several times. I'm going to go back and forth. I'm going to say about 5 or 6 times until you kind of feel like you've got this all nice and secure. There's a random thread that's poking out. Let me do that. And once you have finished doing that poking back and forth, you'll end your thread off in the end cap and your tassel is complete. And how fabulous is that? And look at how beautifully that drapes. Isn't that wonderful? It has such softness to it and it fills the entire center of that end cap. And I just couldn't be more pleased with the way these little fringes turned out. And isn't that ribbon trick cool? I mean, my jaw dropped when I saw that and how beautiful that made the tassel. So I hope that you find that incredibly useful. We're going to come back one more time and I'm going to show you how you're going to end off the silver silk capture chain and we'll attach your tassel to your chain. We've got one last little step for you to do, and this is a really quickie, easy one for you to do before you're ready to wear your necklace. And that is to get the chain ready to be worn. What I've included in your kit for that chain is a chain that I found that I absolutely am so in love with. It's called Silver Silk Capture Chain. And what it is on the inside of the chain is ball chain, you know, like the kind that you have on fans and things like that. And they have different colors of what is in that center. That's the part that's captured. And then the exterior is the actual silver silk part, and that is knitted wire, super, super fine knitted wire. And so the color of the ball chain on the inside peaks out. So you get kind of this cool two-toned effect with most of their pieces. You can get them that are the same color, but it's not quite as fun. I like the bare hint of a two-toned kind of thing going on. So the other thing that I really like about it is that it's a very sturdy chain. So that's the other really good benefit for it. What's in your kit is about 24 inches of length. If you want it for some reason to be shorter than that, it's very simple to cut. So let me show you how you would do that. So here's a little length of a capture chain. And you just take any of your flush cutters and you can kind of see where the balls are inside and you would just cut right in between the balls. And it's very easy to cut like that. To attach the end caps, they come with these end caps that were made for the silver silk. There's a little indent in here for that ball to get hooked inside the inside here. So you don't even have to use glue if you don't want to. Now, if you want to, you can coat just this outside little edge with glue, and that will be just kind of a secondary way of making sure that this stays put. Here's the other thing. If you created a small loop on your tassel because you wanted it to be permanently attached to your chain, then you want to go ahead and string that tassel on now before you attach your end caps and then your clasp, okay? So you just want to make sure to do that. Here, it's just as simple as using I'm going to use my nylon jaw pliers to smush this down so that I make sure that I don't dent the metal on this. You can use a flat nose pliers also, but you want to be really gentle when you do it because you want to try to mitigate getting those dents on there. So this can be a little bit fidgety to do, but I've found that this works really well because I can kind of control what's going on with all my fingers. And you'll smush down and smush down a little bit, like so. Come on, baby, smush for Jilly. Oh, I guess I did smush it and I just didn't even notice. So it's actually attached right now. I would probably smush this down a little bit more, but you will feel the resistance when you kind of give it a little tug that it's secure. There we go. Now I got it really good and smushed. And now that is not coming apart at all. You'll just attach your clasp to the little loop here with a jump ring. Just as simple as that. So you do the same thing on the other side, and voila, you have a fabulous tassel to wear. I hope you enjoy it, and I hope that all your friends are completely envious of your fabulous tassel. And be sure and come and find me. I'm at jillwisemandesigns.com. I'm on Facebook, Jill Wiseman, Jill Wiseman Designs. I'm all over the place. I'm on YouTube. I got stuff for you. Lots of good stuff like this. Enjoy.